Okay, welcome everybody. Happy New Year. Today's topic is about managing point cloud data. And this is a kind of variation on raster data and on vector data. And during this lecture today, I will explain you how this can be done and give an example in PostGIS. But I will also explain to you how it can be done better in the future by not having spatial point clouds with X, Y, Z, but also including the temporal dimension and the scale or importance dimension. And this is based on ongoing research. And you see the whole team of researchers, including several master students. Point cloud data is not a new data type, but the use is growing very, very rapidly. And that causes data management issues due to the volume of data. The three main types of technologies that produce point clouds are the laser scanner. It can be done from the air, helicopter, can be done on the surface by either fixed scanner or a moving scanner mounted on a car or on a bike. Laser scanning is producing enormous amount of points per second. Hundred thousands, really incredible volumes. The second technique that produces also point clouds is multi-beam echo sounding, and that is used in the maritime environment to measure the depth of the river floor, the sea floor, the ocean floors. The principle is a bit the same. It's based on reflection of sound, a bit like what the bats are doing. And that gives an indication for the distance. It's not that easy, but the result is a point cloud, a huge point cloud also. And the third technique, which is becoming more and more popular, is combining of pairs of photographs or whole sets of photographs, and then match corresponding points, and then the images from the photograph, the rows and the columns, they can be converted into 3D points. So with X, Y, and Z coordinates, and also then having color value RGB. Anyhow, result is a huge data set or data sets, very precise. If you think of centimeter accuracy, a lot of information in that data. And very famous data set in the Netherlands is the actual height model of the Netherlands, or AHN. The first one was produced in 2009. It started with 1 point per 16 square meters, so 4 by 4 meters. The second version was from 2014, already at 10 points per square meter. So every square meter, 10 points more or less. And the current versions, AN3 and AN4, have an even higher density. So the result is a huge data set. You could wonder why store point clouds, these huge data sets in a database. The most common practice today is use specific file formats for point clouds. And here you see a number of file formats, LUS or LUSZ or ZLUS. But then you always have to use specific tools or libraries to be able to read the data. And then you have a bunch of files hanging around. In a way, point clouds are a bit similar to raster data. They sample. They are producing huge volumes, and they are relatively static. So once you collected a point cloud, it is unlikely that you will change it a lot, that you will remove points or add new points. Of course, you can rescan again, and you get another point cloud, and you add more and more points. So that is happening quite often in monitoring applications. But changing old and existing data, that does not happen so often. Point clouds are also a bit similar to vector data in the sense that the locations of the point, the X, Y, and the Z, can be arbitrary and not fixed to a grid like raster data. Point clouds can also have other attributes. I already mentioned the color RGB, but you can also have intensity, or when you want to make the point cloud a bit smarter, and then you can add the classification. For example, it is grass, or it is a road, or a building, or a road sign, or whatever classes you define, and you can then use to label the points, which is, by the way, a tricky process. Okay, the current practice of using files is suboptimal from the perspective of data management. So giving multiple users access to the files, mainly reading, perhaps sometimes also updating, for example, we are classifying, and that is not well managed with files. The scalability is also not that nice if you have files hanging around. For example, AHN uses 60,000 individual files to cover the whole country. And yeah, that is not so nice to work with if you have to open every file to see if that file contains relevant points for your query. And when it's in a specific file format, you can only use the tools built for that file format. And yeah, these tools do not allow you to integrate it with other data, vector data, raster data, or administrative data. For example, I have a collection of buildings with owners, and I want to find all the points in the building owned by myself, by Peter. And so I go from administrative table to the polygon table with buildings, and I would like to do a spatial join then with the point cloud data. That is not possible if the point cloud data are in specific files. So you can work around, make kind of solutions for managing, for example, 60,000 files. But it is kind of developing your own database. And actually, there is no reason why a point cloud cannot be supported efficiently in a database. And you can also imagine mixes of both worlds, that you use an efficient file format, for example, with compression that is used in the database to store point cloud blocks. Or you can somehow also have an external wrapper for a file and make it visible in the database if it were a normal table. And I will also explain that later on. First to PostgreSQL, the extension for point clouds is available, and at least an initial extension. And that is kind of the state of the art of point clouds in databases, namely storing the point clouds in blocks of a certain size. And the size means a number of points. The point cloud extension is developed by Paul Ramsey, a very well-known developer in the PostJS community, and you can find his source code here. And in the lab assignments, you will also use the Postgres point cloud extension. You can, for example, if you have your data after a scan stored in a file in loss or loss set format, And loss and loss z are a bit related, but loss z is the compressed version of the loss type of file. You can store that point cloud in the database by loading it via PDOL. And PDOL is the point cloud data abstraction library. And it is a rather efficient method to convert the points from the file into and load them into the database. You have to specify a block size, but the typical size is 5,000. And then on the blocks you create, and every block has about 5,000 points, you create a GST index, which is basically a kind of R tree. And when you're then doing queries later on, you quickly know which blocks you need. So in the green area is representing a part of the Netherlands where I loaded one of the AHN files. And I specified the maximum number of points is 5,000. And I checked after the loading with PDOL into Postgres Point Cloud, what was the result. And actually, I found two types of blocks. I found the majority of blocks had 4,999 points that are the green ones. But somehow the loading procedure made about 100 blocks for this data set with 4,998 that are the red blocks here in the scheme. So the red blocks. And you may notice that there are also some white areas, not that much, but a few. And that is because this area does not contain any points, so there does not have to be a block over there. So actually the blocks are, they are not overlapping, but they can have gaps. And the reason is, for example, that water does not reflect laser scan very well, and therefore don't produce points. And then you get these white areas. So for the block size, you can try different sizes. I tried from 300 to 5,000. You can switch on and off compression. And I did some testing and with this loading and querying the AHN data. And and the main conclusions are here. Compression gives you a factor 2 to 3 smaller, which is fine, but it's not as good as what LossZ is doing to Loss. Then I often get a factor 10 more compact. So that is really good. Load time and storage sizes are linear to the database size. That's what you expect. You have twice the amount of data, then loading takes twice the amount of time. Creating the index is very cheap, relatively. Because it's done on block level, not on point level. The query time are rather stable. I will show you some of the example queries I did. That is due to the index being used. And the compression did not matter so much. At most, there was a variation of 10% in speed. Here are some remarks about Oracle. I will not go into detail. So here were my sample query geometries. A very small rectangle over here, number one, covering a couple of blocks. So keep in mind that a block is about 5,000 points. So this may be a return perhaps 100 or 200,000 points. Well, a big rectangle like number two over here may return easily 1 million or 2 million points. Also some nasty objects like a very thin diagonal polygon or a polygon with a hole or a circular shape to get a feeling about the robustness of the implementation. And here is an example query for query number one. the query polygons are stored in the table and they have an identifier. And so I select the polygon with identifier one, which was the rectangle, small rectangle. I combine it with the point cloud patch table. And the condition is that the patch have to intersect the query geometry. And this patch from the point cloud table is then actually intersected with the geometry. And so the patch is a kind of rectangle, but if the query geometry is a circle, only the points really in the circle will be selected. And they will be exported as points as x, y, z values. So this is an example query. Okay, this is basic state of the art point cloud data in databases. We want to push this forward with what we call an ND point cloud, not just a 3D point cloud, but say a higher dimensional point cloud. And as you can imagine, scale is one of the possible dimensions, like in the video scale mapping. First, we'll do the discrete levels of detail, and next, the continuous level of detail. Then I give a list of options of what you can do on the point clouds directly. Then we go into depth on the data management of the individual points. A technique to improve the data management via a histogram. And finally, a trick or a technique to keep the points in a file, but be able to use them in a database. And that's called the foreign data ribbon. And finally, the conclusions. In principle, all attributes of a point can also be seen as dimensions. There could be a temperature at that location, or the sound, or the RGB value. All these different dimensions or attributes, I group them into two categories. The first category is organizing dimensions. I use them to organize the data in the space. So they drive the spatial sorting, clustering, and indexing. And good candidates are, of course, the X and the Y, perhaps also the Z or the time. Then there are property dimensions. These are dimensions which are hanging along with the point. You don't select in the where clause based on this property, for example, the color, the flow, velocity, intensity, pressure, or whatever. You select on location and time, and then you want to retrieve also the other ones. These dimensions are important, but they do not organize the data well. They are not used in the where clause. And it is not fixed what is an organizing dimension and what is a property dimension. That depends on the application. Okay, point clouds are often used to monitor. And as a result, you get multiple scans of the same region. And that gives you, you could say, a dynamic point cloud. Another example of a point cloud, and very different from the laser scanning of the multi-beam echoes or the dense matching, is all the trajectories produced by, say, mobile phones. They are also locations, XY, perhaps XYZ, and time. And these are also very massive because there are millions of phone users, and every few seconds a new position is being computed. So time is very important in addition to location. What's also very important is level of detail or scale. And it has to do with the large data sets, the volume. And if you would not organize the point clouds in levels of details or at multiple scales, then it is really impossible to use them well. And for point clouds, we use the same trick or technique. We use the scale or importance value as an additional dimension to organize the point clouds. So as a result, we now have to organize, say, 4D or 5D point clouds. So I've seen these examples of time as a dimension in addition to location. And this was really a point cloud application from Rijkswaterstaat and Deltares, where they are scanning the coast very often and generate new point clouds. And this challenge was investigated in a master thesis of Stella Sombadaki 4 years ago. Okay, scale as dimension, it's a bit less obvious than time. From the rasters, we remember well the data pyramids. We have the different levels of detail. At the top, the coarse level of detail, and at the bottom, the fine level of detail, and in the middle, the medium level of detail. And this is a kind of multi-scale representation, not vario-scale, if you would organize the point clouds at a number of levels, but it's a good approach. This is a reminder of how we did this vector data. Vector data was hard because we had to remain the topology between the edges and the faces. When we have just points and point clouds, there is no topology. So I think point clouds will be the third main representation for spatial temporal things. After the grids or the rasters, the voxels, or the vector or the object representations. Today they are mainly used as a data acquisition technique, and that is because the tools are not so mature to handle the point clouds, to do functions analysis on point clouds. But due to ongoing research and implementation, this will change in the future. And also there will be standards for point clouds and better implementations. But in all scientific domains that are spatial, you see point clouds, of course, in GIS on geography, but also in medical application or in physics, astronomy, hydrology, architecture, and so on. We need this deep integration of say space, time, and scale to more efficiently store and exchange the data, but also to do the computations more efficient. And this deep integration gives us also new functionality, like the smooth zoom, if you remember it from the Vario scale or the perspective view. And in the future, point clouds should not only be data acquisition technique, but it should also be used in the storage, in the analysis, in the computation or simulation, and in disseminating and visualizing. But okay, it's big data. For example, there are point clouds of 35 trillion points in astronomy, and also the point clouds created by Cyclomedia are at this level, and 35 trillion points is a lot. You write it down with all the zeros instead of the word trillion, then you see how much it is. Okay, I said scale is a bit a funny dimension, so let's have a look at it. We developed it, this dimension based on the idea of the data pyramid. And in this data pyramid at the bottom, we have the fine detail, so a lot of points. And then at the higher levels, we have fewer points. And one way of computing that is that when we have we are inserting points in the database, and we have points in the fine grid, the finest grid at the bottom, then when we would get another point, that would not be stored in the fine grid, but that would go to the next higher level, to the parent cell. And there is also a grid, but with double the resolution, so four times fewer cells covering the same space. And okay, we repeat this, and then in the end we get a data pyramid with a discrete number of levels. And how high we get, that would depending on the initial data density. So here is a very simple example. At the bottom, there are the most points. I will call this level 0. And at the medium level, we have half of the number of points. And at the top, we have again half of the number of points, or a quarter of the points at the bottom. So these are, you could say, data blocks, also handy to store. If we stretch this pyramid to the real size of the domain, and this is a kind of simple side view of a domain, then we see that in the higher dimensions, in the higher levels of detail in the pyramid, the data becomes more sparse. And the lower you go, the higher the density gets. This is a 2D example. So then between every level, there's a factor of 4 in density difference, and also the number of blocks. And in 3D, you would get a factor 8. Okay, one way to get this distribution is saying, okay, we make a number of intervals, and every time, and assume we have an n-dimensional problem, and that means we have 2 to the power of n as a factor between the different levels. Then the first interval would be the top, with only a very short interval from 0 to 1. Then the next interval would be from 1 to 2 to the power of n plus 1, so containing 2 to the power of n. That is this interval nodes. Then we go to the next level, starts at 2 to the power of n plus 1, but it ends at 2n to the power. And so that is, so if n would be 2, then it would be 4, 2 to the power 4. So every line segment on this line represents a range corresponding to the number of points that fit in a level. And now we have points without any importance or level. And then we randomly add this level by doing random sampling and distributing the points over this interval. And then we look, okay, in what interval do you end up? And there we know what level the point is belonging to. And so most points will belong to the last interval, which is the longest, and a very few points to the first, only one. Okay, this was implemented in what is called the SFC lib. in a very fast manner. Okay, once we have constructed this data pyramid, we can use it as a kind of multi-scale representation. And quite often with 3D point cloud data sets, you also have perspective views. So imagine I'm standing here and I'm looking in this direction. Then nearby me, I want to see a lot of detail because there is a lot of space on the screen nearby me. A little bit further away, I want to have medium detail, so I get bigger blocks. And far away, I get the biggest block to give the more coarse detail. Okay, this works well. The drawback, of course, discrete number of levels. Also, the way it's filled, you could be argued, that it may not give a balanced top. And it's a bit random. It does not really look at the actual geometry or configurations. It just assigns an importance level to a point. Okay, this is a viewer we developed for AAN. And okay, this is 640 billion points, so not even 1 trillion. I can give a short demo now. Go to browser. Start with go to the viewer. Gives me information. But okay, this is AAN data of the whole of the Netherlands, and you see the blocks coming. I can zoom in to any location. I can rotate. And I can also type a location, for example, Delft. And I jump to that location and again, I see how the things are organized in blocks. You see the search in the center. And this is our own building over here. Rotating a bit around it. You recognize the front entry here, I guess. You can play with settings, for example, the number of points or the quality of the rendering. So this is standard, but when you do this ultra rendering, you get a bit of shading. And then you see even more detail. But you will notice that your system will get slower. Okay, that was the AAN viewer, but it is fantastic that you can see the whole country, all points, and very interactively. They are at a server in Delft, but I am now at home with a normal internet connection, and it works really, really well. And that is due to good data organization. Okay, there are some alternatives for the data pyramid. I now use the random, but I could also do some kind of analysis, compute local data density. And when it's a very dense area, I make the points less important to compensate for the density. Or look at the local shape. For example, if there is some kind of surface with an edge, or a ridge, I could make that a bit more important near the edge and near flat areas a bit less important to emphasize the changes in the in the environment. And so, for example, make corners of buildings stand out compared to the facades. But you can also imagine other criteria and have some kind of other way to compute the importance of a point better than random. Okay, we were bothered by this block effect, and we had an investigation by Jippe van der Made, also a master's student of geomatics, and he did a thesis project on how to get rid of this. And it was a kind of post-processing, and so the data was still stored in the blocks of the data pyramid, but a kind of shaved off. Not sure how to call it. But here you see the data pyramid with the jumps. And what he did was, okay, throwing away some of the points. And I can better draw it with a pen. But the pen was a nicer color. So throwing away some points. I'm not sure why he's doing that, funny. So everything here is removed. Pen has some artifacts. And then you keep this smooth end result. And this gives a gradual transition from the viewer into the distance. And the trick was, okay, which points to keep and which ones to throw away was, assume the viewer is at the camera position, looking in this direction. A point is selected from the block. When there is free space around it, and the radius around it is varying with the distance to the camera, but when there is free space, then the point is used, and so that is kept over here. When it will be overlapping, and for example, when I would have another point over here, this was the center point, and then this circle would overlap. So this one is not used. We had to remove about 70 to even 90% of the points to get really a smooth result where we could not see the artifact of a block anymore. So that's not so efficient. Another researcher from, this one is from TU Vienna, Marco Schütz, he's a developer of poetry, is based on also post-processing. And that technique was a little bit more what we already said by, it's based on adding a random number. Of course, you first retrieve the blocks, and then the points you retrieved get a random number. And then based on the distance to the viewer, you compute the density you want. And the random number is just between 0 and 1 in the example of Marco Schütz. And the ratio between 0 and 1 he selects is an indication of the density he will get. Okay, assuming that he knows the density of the blocks. But it's based on the same principle, throwing away some points of the blocks. But he could make a very nice virtual reality application. And he could load 68 million points in the memory of the GPU and give them this additional random number. And then for really drawing, he selects 5,000 most important points according to the perspective view, and then draw 90 frames per second, both left and right. So that's very fast. Okay, it's time for the first break. If there are no questions, it's now 14:24. So we'll have a break until 14:29. I will check if there are no questions in the chat. No, chat is empty. You're still getting used to the new year. See you back in 5 minutes. Okay, let's start again. We have a lot to cover. I'm afraid it will be difficult to finish in time, but I want to explain it clear. Okay, if it's not clear, by the way, please open your microphone and ask a question, interrupt me, or put your question in the chat. So now, let's try to get rid of the discrete levels of detail. And these ugly artifacts, you always see them. Okay, in post-processing, you can remove a little bit the visual effects, but it's not so efficient. And so we are wondering, would not be a true value scale option be possible for point clouds, similar to the vector map value scale? And the lesson we learned from the vector map value scale was that we add one dimension to the geometry to represent the value scale. And then we could get continuous levels of detail. And that meant that the 2D geometry became a 3D geometry. And we could apply this to point cloud data. So we could compute the importance or the CLMD value, add that to the other organizing dimensions, for example, X, Y, and importance, and Z could be an other attribute. Or we do it in a four-dimensional way, X, Y, Z, and importance, no, not including time. Then index the resulting point set and cluster, and then do selections based on the points we need. For example, we're viewing, it will be a view frustum. And nearby a lot of points, and further away gradually less points, and not in the block manner. And this is the sketch. And this is the data cube or the hyper data cube with the X, Y, Z points. And a level of detail, continuous level of detail. And I'm that little guy. I'm watching in that direction, in the view direction. And yeah, the blue volume is what I want to select. And so nearby, I want to select a lot of points. So from low to high importance, and gradually further away, only the important points and not the unimportant points. So this is the idea. And yeah, we want to have a kind of similar distribution as the ideal data pyramid. So it's the factor 4 in 2 dimensions or factor 8 in 3 dimensions per level, but without having discrete levels. And I wanted this for many years. And when we developed this viewer for AAN, that was 4 or 5 years ago, I already did not like that. And it took a long time to come up with a solution. And finally, last year, there was a solution. And when you see the solution, you say, okay, why did it take so long? Okay, this is the ideal distribution. On one level, I can store, say, one point. And on the next level, I can, this is a one-dimensional example. I can store the double amount of points. On the next level, I can again store double amount of the points. And on the next level, I can again store the double amount of points. So that means the number of points are 2 to the power 0, 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 2, and 2 to the power 8, or 1, 2, 4, and 8. And if I look at all the numbers put on one line from 0% to 200%, this is a kind of the probability distribution over the levels. The same as what I showed in the interval. And this is still discrete with 4 levels. And the probability that you assign a point to level L is given by this function to the power level L assigned, divided by the total number of points. That is total plus zero. And the total number of points is given by this expression from L is zero to the big L, sum two to the power L's. Okay, this is the 1D case. In case this 2D or 3D or ND replace the two and the base over here and by two to the power N. And then it works also for the other dimensions. Okay, but this is discrete. Then the simple idea was, okay, we know how much we want to have at what level. What if we halve the levels? So from zero to half, and from half to one, from one to one and a half to two, and so on. And these two together are the odds a level one or level zero, 6.7. And if we do the same computation with the two to the power of the level, and we not only have integer levels like zero and one and two, but also a half and one and a half and two and a half, then the number of points that fit in such a level symbolically is not also not only integer values, but are also values in between, like 1.4 and 2.8 and 5.6. The nice thing is that when I now add two halves, their numbers or their percentage, I get the old percentage of the corresponding level. And I can do that also at this level, and at this level, and at the last level. And here you see the refined probability distribution. So this is not only integer levels, but also levels with halves. Okay, when you can do it once, you can do it a second time. And now every original level is subdivided into four sublevels, from zero to a quarter, from a quarter to a half, from half to three quarter, and from three quarter to one, and so on. And I do also to the power a quarter and to a power three quarter. And then I get all these numbers. And again, when I sum the original, the four components of an original level, I get the same amount of the original level. And so this is what I mean with the original distribution. And here you see the whole range. Okay. And so the probability that you assign a point to a level with a certain refinement, as you can have two refinements or three refinements that will increase the number of fine levels you get. It's this expression, a bit similar. So two to the power of the level, and the level can then be three and a half or 3.75 divided by this total, total R, and total R is total zero and this expression. This is a big, so this is the notation for the multiplication of all these factors over here. So believe me that this is correct. So assume now that we have endpoints in the whole data set, and the size of the domain, of the n-dimensional domain, and note that it is a data cube, so all sizes are equal for all dimensions. So they all have size E, edge size. Then the density, the average overall density, is the number of points by the total volume or hypervolume of the domain, e to the power n. So n, big N, divided by e to the power of small n. And okay, we still we had our probability function with refinement R, and there is a direct relationship between the level and the density you get. And so this density with R refinements in the ND case at level say 3.25 is the probability at this level times the number of points divided by the size or the volume of the whole domain. And so this is important, a direct relation between the level and the density. And so we can use the level to manipulate the density of the points we want to select. Okay, we're nearly there. If we keep on refining the discrete levels, in the end, if we do it infinitely, we get a continuous distribution. And the function that belongs to this continuous distribution over the levels is given here. And this is the commutative distribution function given here. And with this function, I now assign a non-integer, let's say, so really a variable number between zero and the number of levels I want, and so that is L plus one, in via this expression. And so using the random generator, giving me a point between zero and one, putting it in the formula as given over here, then I get the ideal distribution of the points, not at discrete levels, but at continuous levels. And here you see 11 levels with two refinements. So that means 22 levels in one dimension. Instead of hand drawing, this was now programmed. And here you see some more examples with three levels that are refined in the end 10 times. And you already see that after five refinements, at the discrete levels, our function is very close to the red, which is the continuous function, proving that the continuous function is indeed correct. So this is for an example with five levels, and this is for an example with 14 levels. And 14 levels is actually what we used for the AHN example I did demonstrate before the break, the short break. So that was from refined discrete to continuous level in the one-dimensional case, but going to the n-dimensional case is near trivial. And you see also the formulas are very much the same. Okay, it's not really trivial. You have to think about it a little bit. But it does work. And again, as what we had with the refined discrete, also for the continuous distribution, there is a direct, in ND, there's a direct relationship between the level and the density, and that is given over here. Okay, an example, because it is very abstract to look at the formulas, and the example hopefully makes it a little bit easier to understand. Assume we have a two-dimensional world with points, So this square. And so the little n is 2. It's 5 by 5 meters, so it's a small world. So the edge size is 5. And I have 10 million points. So the big N is 10 million. And for some reason, I decide in my big L, the number of levels is 6. That means my little L is a real number between 0 and 7, or floating point number between 0 and 7. Okay, the maximum density is when I use all the points. Okay, that is 10 million. And I have 25 square meters. So that is 400,000 points per square meter. When I apply the formulas, for example, at and I enter the E is 5 and the N is 2 and the big N is 10,000 and the L is 6, I get this expression for the commutative density function. And assume I want to display on my screen 100,000 points, because that looks good. And my selection, my zoom area is now 1 by 1 meter. Then we're saying, okay, when I want to have this amount of points, I can compute that I have to select everything up to level 5.03. And that is a density of 100,000 points per square meter. When I make the box bigger, I need to select, again, I want to select 100,000 points. So I'm zooming out, so the bigger box is displayed again on my screen. But that means the data density is dropped to 25,000 points per square meter, or I need to select the points up to level 3,16, and so on. And so when I select a certain area of a certain size, and I have a budget, how many points I do want to select, and I have an average density, then by specifying the level, I can select it from the database. If I organize the points based on location, say X and Y and level, I can do it very fast. Okay. Here are some other more tricky examples, not about a rectangle, but about a triangle. And a triangle that is used for perspective view. So in the boxes, I had constant density. So this little box, I had high density, the medium box had medium density, and the big box had low density. With the perspective view, I want to have a varying density. And high density near to the viewer and low density far away. And assume I have it 1 meter distance from the viewer, and the level would be 5.03. When I'm at 2 meters, it should be 3.16, and so on. And then I get this. And okay, these are sample values, because it is, of course, true everywhere in between. Okay, I can also zoom in and zoom out and do an efficient selection or change perspective. So that is actually making the view angle wider or more narrow. Okay, in summary, we finally managed to get rid of the discrete levels with this continuous function. And by assigning a random number, which is then computed, converted to a level, we get the ideal distribution. This was also implemented in a viewer by, in this case, by Xuefen Guan at Wuhan University, and he was a visitor in Delft for 1 year. And I can also try to do this demo. Let me get a bit my pointer. Okay, it's now back. So I switch to the view one. Just loading points. Okay, I can rotate it. And one of the nice things, and you have to play with it, zoom. You don't see so much the different levels now. I'll make it kind of some settings. A nice thing is I can show the level of detail values. And so this is the L value used to select the points. From red means very unimportant to blue, far away, to very important points. And so this is the bottom level L used to select. Okay, let's go back to the slides. Another implementation of the continuous level of detail was very recently in a master thesis project by Mu-Xian Deng. And it was about a mobile augmented reality. So a mobile phone was used. And when you were looking through your camera, you could superimpose additional objects. It was an indoor application. So some of the sample objects were new furniture, and there were models, point cloud models of the furniture available, and those were added to the camera vision, and you could walk around then the chair if it was there, and you would always see it correctly. And yeah, of course, mobile phones have limited computing resources. And yeah, this was the first time ever that somebody tried to use point cloud models in a mobile phone. They're using the CLOD, or the continuous level of detail, and the distance to the viewer, and the proper amount of points could be selected, which were, say, optimal for showing the objects quite reasonable, but still not too many to slow down the rendering. And this, if you want to try it, the source code is available on this link on GitHub, including also the sample data sets. Some other applications here are also that you could put a model of a city on your table. You could use the AAN point cloud of a certain city and put it on your table and walk around it a bit like a maquette. So that's another type of application. Okay, one more block and then a little break again. Functionality. Okay, so by not seeing point clouds as just a data collection technique, but also as a representation, there are a lot of benefits. And there is no conversion to another representation, to a grid or to vectors or polyhedral models. There's also no data loss, because small details can be very important. For some types of analyses, I think it's even better. Try to represent vegetation with a vector model or with a raster models. Imagine how your bushes and your trees would look like. And with a point cloud, you can have a really realistic representation of vegetation. We have a very simple continuous LOD implementation. So with raster, we are limited to the factor 2 per level. Okay, we started with that also for the point cloud, but we got rid of it. And we have now the continuous levels. And it gives you really realistic representations. So it is capturing reality. There are drawbacks, and that is the volume of the data that makes potentially algorithms slow. And we have to redevelop algorithms that were built on, on raster data models or on vector data models. Of course, we have the option still to convert from the point cloud to a vector model and then do the analysis, or from the point cloud to a raster representation and then do the analysis on the raster. But it is nicer to do it directly on the point cloud. We already did try some types of spatial analysis directly on the point cloud. For example, compute the solar energy potential on the roofs and facades of building. And that is basically also computing a ray from the sun to the roof points. But if there are occluders like neighbor buildings or big trees, then you get shadow and you don't get the energy potential. And these types of computations are really more precise than the grid or vector counterparts. We also did some viewshed or line of sight analysis, including vegetation. That was done by Guanting during her visit as a PhD student in 2017. And it's a time expensive analysis. We could include vegetation very well in computing the view sheds. You see the lines that are free of sight are here, but you see also block lines by vegetation. You can also compute routes, even in 3D, because if you have a point cloud of all your objects, and if you have, for example, a drone which you want to route through a building, then the drone can go everywhere except where there's a point. So the drone has to go through the free space. And so this is a point cloud-based path for a drone. Okay, same for change detection, deformations, volume analysis of buildings, hydrology, flow over surfaces. And we did not yet realize it, but with using also the structure of the continuous level of detail, we can also say speed up the analysis at the level of detail we want. And so CLOD is also useful for computation and not only for visualization. Okay, here is a really a long list of things that you would like to do with point clouds in a database. So this first one is select based on a rectangle. And the second one is select all points along a route, so linear object trajectory. Could be a highway or it could be a power cable, and so on, including the conversions to other representations like the grid or the vector, the thin representation. I will go over all the options here. Okay, in the last part, I will go into the details, how we could manage the ND point clouds in an efficient manner. It is now 14:57, so we'll continue in 5 minutes. This is 15:03. I will check if there are any questions. No? In the chat. No, you are all very calm in the new year. Listening carefully. Okay, see you back in 5 minutes. Okay, welcome back. Let's start with the last part of the lecture today. Now, we have seen the need of ND point clouds. How can we actually manage them efficient? And as said, the organizing dimensions are important there. And the properties, the other properties are nice, but the organized dimensions are used in the data organization, in the clustering, in the indexing, in the subdivision or creating blocks for parallel processing. I will now present a solution which is using a technique you now well know, that's the space filling curve. So the ND point cloud is converted to one-dimensional value, the SFC key. And that will be a quadrant recursive space filling curve. So there's a relation to a quad tree or an op tree. So it's quite hard to think what would be a good storage model for the data if you have ND data. For now, assume 2D space and time, because it depends on what you are asking, what you are querying. Do you query a time needle? So on one location, you want to know all the values over time. So that's the left picture. Or do you want to have a spatial temporal query? So you specify a little extended area and also a time interval with, which is rather restrictive, or is it just a time slice query? You want to see your whole domain at one moment in time. And okay, depending on how the points are stored, the certain queries are easier or more difficult to be answered. And as a rule, you want to store query close together when they are asked together.
Peter, you didn't share your screen.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, the screen share is not on. Yeah, very good. Over here. Thanks for the warning. Okay, it should be visible now. So here you see the three options for the three different types of selection. And yeah, the trick is to store points close together, which are asked close together. And that is often, of course, based on the location, but also on time. And yeah, you could use the space filling curve. Imagine again the example of the 2D space and time. We could make a 3D space filling curve shown to the left. This is a Morton curve in 3D with X, Y, and time. Or we could do a 2D Morton curve for every time slice from T1 to the last one, Tn. And if I want to retrieve a time slice, okay, the second organization is quicker. If I do a spatial temporal query, then the first organization is quicker. And so, there is no one single answer. It depends on your data set, it depends on your queries, what is a good organization. And aspects that are relevant are, okay, the decision on the organization dimensions, and the other attributes, the associated attributes, the type of curve you use, Morton or Hilbert or other techniques like a KD tree or ND simplices to organize the points, how to scale the different dimensions. Okay, X and Y are perhaps easy because you can say, okay, you can use the same units, meters. But okay, how to scale the time? Is 1 hour 1 meter, or is 1 second 1 meter? And that does have an influence on the key. and therefore also on the clustering on the spatial and curve key. And then the settings for block size, the clustering and compression. Okay, you all know this very well from the lecture on the space filling curves. So it's a technique to get a linear ordering for a multi-dimensional domain from points in ND to points in 1D. And the idea is now that we use full resolution keys. That is, we do this bitwise interleaving of X, Y, and time, or Z, or level of detail. And we use all the bits of the X and the Y and the Z. We will get a big key, but we don't need the X, Y, and the Z and time anymore, or the importance, because they are somehow encoded in the key. And it makes it efficient. Now, with this key, we put them in a database table. And a very good way is an indexed organized table. And that means actually that the data itself is stored in the index. So we don't have a separate table for the data and a structure for the index. No, it is one structure that has both the index and the data together. And that is very fast, efficient, and also compact. Yeah, both Morton and Hilbert, as you remember, can be specified in ND and are quadrant recursive. This is the overall scheme of the data management and the querying, and in the upper right corner over here, or actually over here, you see the loading. So we have a point cloud, usually stored in the file, loss file, loss set file. We compute the space filling curve keys, the SFC keys, full resolution, and we store that in the database, preferably in an IoT table, index organized table. So then we are finished, we are ready with the loading. This can be a lot of work if we have a lot of data, a lot of pre-processing. Okay, then the querying. And the querying is rather tricky. That is the remainder of this scheme. And what we do is we convert the query geometries, for example, the rectangle or the circle or the polygon with a hole, to ranges with begin and end of the SFC curve. And then we put these ranges in the table over here. So this is a table with begin end. And the begin ends correspond to the query geometry. And so we kind of convert the query geometry from a normal, say, polygon or polyhedral representation to a set of ranges. And then we do a join with the table. And then we get the points that are inside the ranges or inside the query geometry. And this is the answer. The ranges, as I will show you later, are always a kind of approximation. A little bit like a bounding box is an approximation of a polygon. It's a bit more refined, but it is not exact. And therefore, we can do the second filter, and that is to do a really a point inside the query geometry test, but only of the points that are selected after the first filter. Okay, this is an illustration that the Morton curves works in also in 3D, but it works in ND. I cannot really show it very well. It is bitwise interleaving, but you can imagine that goes very well in N dimension. A bit of X, a bit of Y, a bit of Z, a bit of the time, a bit of the importance, the second bit of X, the second bit of Y, the second bit of Z, the second bit of time, the second bit of importance, the third bit of X, and so on. That works really well. Then you get a 4D or a 5D clustering. So you see the Hilbert curve in 3D, and this was the modern curve, Hilbert curve. So the first thing we tried, that was make a separate table, loaded the points and created the B3 index on the SFC key. And yeah, that what you could do is then walk the curve and create blocks out of that. Later we discovered that using an indexed organized table, so not a separate table, which is called a heap table, and a separate index, is the best solution. And yeah, what you could do is, instead of storing also the X, Y, the Z, and time and the importance, only store the key. So that is really compact and you have all the information, but it must be a high resolution key. Okay, this is how you create an index organized table in Oracle. So it's a normal create table statement, create table, point cloud demo. It has an attribute, the Hilbert code or Morton code. There is a number and it's also the primary key. The primary key means it will be indexed or organized on that. And now there is an additional clause saying organization index. And this makes it an index organized table. So very simple. Unfortunately, Postgres does not have an index organized table. Because that is the IoT of Oracle also takes care of the clustering. What we could do is having a kind of pseudo clustering in Postgres. We make a normal table, create table, point cloud demo, the key, the type big int, it's also primary key. And after that we say we cluster the table on the key. That means we are influencing the order. And that can only be done, this clustering, when it has a primary key. That means primary key that there is also an index created. But it is not dynamic. So when we insert or delete points, it will not be maintained. That is not the case for Oracle. The IoT over there is dynamic. So the lessons we learned is that the IoT is a very efficient structure, to have the table and the index together. When we have the full resolution key, we can omit storing the attributes separately. The high resolution key does require large keys, sometimes not fitting into 64 bits. So we need to have other encodings, maybe varchar or raw bytes. Initially, we did not implement it inside the database, but the SFC encoding and decoding outside the database, and we had quite some communication overhead. The role of organizing and other attributes are application dependent, context dependent, the scaling is needed. And with the SFC ranges for a polygon or a diagonal line, we can have a very much more efficient filtering than, say, a simple bounding box. The ranges we generate to approximate the query geometry are really a lot. And this is one of the biggest problems we now still have. So this is an overview of what we implemented. We have an encode function. So that goes from the point in the domain to the SFC key, which is then stored. We have a decode. That means we have the SFC key and we are in the domain, we get back the points, the X, the Y, the Z. And we have also a function to go from the query geometry, polyline with buffer, a circle, a polygon in a domain to the ranges. So the first one is really for storing the encode. The third one is for querying. And yeah, the second one to decode it's nice to have the SFC key, but sometimes you want to show it or depict it, or and then you need to decode it. We've also defined some functions to create tables to have these SFC point clouds, and also a function to drop it. This you may remember, the encode is rather simple. If I have a coordinate, say in this case a 2D example, x is 1 and y is 2, then the encode will be this bit pattern or decimal value 6. Here is another example. And so this is a simple encoding function. So if x is 6 and y is 7, then the SFC key is 61 decimal for this bit pattern. So very easy. Okay, the range functions. So I have a query geometry. This is this polygon over here. It is overlapping with different quadrants of the quad tree, and especially here in the southwest. We call this quadrant or quad code 0. It's completely overlapping. And the northwest, we subdivide the quadrant into two sub quadrants that are also overlapping. And in this corner, we are going to sub quadrants, refining two times. And you see that to every part of these quadrants, a quad code, 0, this is 10, because remember the N shape. Of the Morton key, so this is 0, here is the 1. Here is the 2, and here is the 3. So therefore this quadrant gets 0, this gets 1, but it is subdivided. And so this is the subdivision over here. And then this is, overall it's 1, but at the second level this is the 0, and this will be the 1, and this is the 2, so this is 12. And this will be 2, and this is 3, but it is subdivided. And then it is 0 because it's the first one, like this over here. And this one is subdivided. And it's again 0. So I get 4 quad codes that indicate this polygon. And a quad code is corresponding to a Morton range, right, or SFC range. And the smaller the quad code is, the bigger the range is. And so the first one corresponds to 16 values. From 0 to 15. That is obvious, and the quad code 10 corresponds to 4 values, and the quad code 300 just to 1 value. There are some gaps between the first range and the second range. The gap is 0, but between the second range and the third range, from 19 to 24, the gap is 4. And there is a gap from 27 to 84. And so this set of ranges is corresponding to the query geometry. I remember that. This is the recursive function to compute these ranges. And you have to specify at the depth of the recursion, how fine you want to recurse. And basically in this function there are three cases. The quad is completely covered, it is completely disjoint, or it is partly. So completely covered is easy. You write the range that corresponds to the quad, and you are finished. You don't have to go any deeper. When the quadrant is disjoint, it's also easy. You don't have to do anything. You're also finished, but you don't write anything, no range. Only when you're partly overlapping, then you are going to recurse and going to refine the current quads into four subquads and call the same function again. Okay, to get rid of some of the ranges, you can glue them. And yeah, to glue them, it is best to sort them on the gap. And so gluing a distance zero is for free. That does not add additional space. But if you glue two ranges where there is a little gap, that means adding a little bit of space. Okay, that's not so bad. But with that, you reduce the number of ranges, and then the query in the database becomes simpler. So it's quite tricky to get ready for your database queries. So that's the drawback of this way of representing everything with the SFC keys. And so this is the balancing. The deeper the recursion, and the more ranges you generate, and so the more fine you represent the query geometry, less unwanted points. But the more ranges make the query in the end slower. So not go too deep in recursion and merge nearby ranges. And it is balancing at the query precision versus the query speed. And we did do several experiments. You see an example, there's a circle, which is approximated by these cells, the quad codes at different levels. And the original one is represented by 176 cells, and big ones, medium ones, small ones. And you see the small ones are nearly always near the boundary. That makes sense, because if you're completely inside, you can use a big quad. If you are completely outside, you don't have to do anything, no range. And so every cell now corresponds to a range. So the simple thing is merging neighbor ranges, and that is for free, and you don't add any space. And you get, say, sometimes strange shapes, even non-rectangular, like this one. But it adds no space at all, and it reduces the number of ranges. Significantly, we have 42. But if I, for some reason, I want to have just 30 or 20 ranges, I have to merge more. And when I do that, I add additional space that did not belong to my initial approximation. So benefit fewer ranges, only 30. Instead of 42, or only 20 instead of 30, but every time I add a bit of more space. And so it's an approximation technique, you could say. This is how the query would look when you would do it with a where clause, where you select the codes, the SFC key, or the Hilbert or Morton codes, in the range between the begin and the end value of the range. Then you have many ranges. Now you can imagine this is not a nice query. And so it is nicer to store all these ranges in a temporary table and then do a join with that table. Okay, some testing without the Morton key to sort and structure the table. Q1, 4, and 7 relate to these objects, so the small box and the circle and the big box. Oh, 7 is the line, so the small rectangle, the circle, and the line. every time we had more data stored in the database, and I tried to add, say, a factor 10 more data, and do the same query, but the data is elsewhere, just to see how efficient the selection is. It becomes three times slower, more or less. Every factor of 10 more data makes it three times slower. And this is with indexing on the SFC key. This is on the X, Y, and Z indexing. Indexing on the modern code keeps the query response time and for all the queries more or less stable. And so there is some fluctuation, but that is more random than significant. So you can guarantee constant response time. And also always faster than the original indexing of X, Y, and Z, and not the modern value. Okay, very quickly about the problem we had with the drawback of the SFC approach. Okay, I explained about the big keys we need. This needs attention. But I want to spend some time on this what I call the curse of the range explosion. If you want to have a very precise representation of a query geometry, I get really a lot of ranges. And that makes it slow. I need them to make the query precise. And it gets even worse in ND. And it can be that I'm now making, so imagine that we have AN data, and so points on the surface of the Earth. And I have a query and specify a rectangle, but actually it's a prism in 3D space, because I want to have all points in that 2D area. It corresponds to a 3D prism. And that means I need to cover my query geometry, the prism, with all the ranges. And what we see is that, quite often, the spaces may contain no point or sparse in certain areas. But I spend a lot of energy on generating ranges to avoid that. And the ND histogram was invented to generate not so detailed ranges where there is no data or few data. And so it's a kind of a spatial histogram. And this kind of quadri, 2 to the power n tree, contains a count of the points. So it does not contain the point itself. And so it's really a histogram. It's not having a reference to the points, it is just having a count of the points. So I know in this area, it is more dense than this area. And it's also an adaptive count, because if there will be more than 100 points in an area, I subdivide the area into four parts, or eight parts in 3D. And I keep the count for every part. And this is what is called the ND histogram or the hist tree. So it contains a density estimation, which is specific to locations in ND space. And now when I do a query, I check my query geometry with the nodes. And the red case is the worst case. The query geometry is partially overlapping or intersecting with the query geometry, and the node is partly overlapping. So I need to refine. When I have a white node, then I'm completely outside and I'm ready. Don't have to do anything. When I have here a green node in this imagination, the cell is completely inside the query geometry and I have to report the whole range, no refinements. But when I have an orange node, I have an intersect. And normally with an intersect, I would refine. But this intersect is in a cell which has a few points. So, okay, why would I refine the range, the cells here and make more ranges? when there are only a few points in the space. And I know that's because of the histogram. So I stop the recursion, I do not refine, I do not generate more ranges, I'm ready with this node. So this is how the histogram works. We did some testing, again, a number of query geometries, part of AN data. And we tested with 3D and with 4D data organizations. So it was X, Y, Z, and importance, or X, Y, and importance in 3D. And here you see the exact answer of the first query, which is a 2D box or a prism. And without the histogram, the retrieval is a bit more, 4.5%. And in this case, with the histogram, it's 4.3, so a little bit less. But in some more difficult queries, the retrieved number of points, for example, query 4 and 5, is really significantly more than the points we do really need. And that is because somehow it is difficult to specify the query geometry precisely. There's a limited number of ranges, and note, limited is not that limited, but as we tested with 100 million ranges, not that limited at all. But we saw a reduction up to a factor of 5 of false positives. And so that makes it a more sharper query, and therefore also faster. Last topic of this lecture, super quick. This is a kind of mixing of the file system solution and the database. So there are very nice file formats for point clouds. Like I said, the last Z, it's kind of efficient, no overhead, there are good tools, but you cannot combine it with other data. It is not so scalable. Then we have the database with the query language combining with other data. You can do updates and inserts. But okay, there is some slow loading of the point clouds, and it is not as efficient as a compressed file. So the hybrid solution looked like this. We keep the data in the files, but we make a kind of what is called a foreign data wrapper around the files. And we make that show to the database as a table, and that's called an external table. And so here we have the actual file in loss or loss set format. We make this such a file can also have its own organization, an own index at file level. Then we have the wrapper. Here we have the database, which is accessing via the wrapper the data in the file. By the way, this was the thesis work of Mu-Xiang Deng, who graduated 3 months ago. The data wrapper was developed in the Postgres SQL environments. You have to define a server, and that is a way to connect to the external table, external data source. And with the foreign table, you define the content of that source, X, Y, Z, and perhaps intensity or RGB. And the platform was used was the multi-core platform for the foreign data wrapper. And it was implemented in Python. So here we have all the point clouds, laser scan, LiDAR files, the indexing, and we have the loss tools, which is a very well-known library or package of software for point cloud files. We have here a bit of explanation of the foreign data wrapper. Okay, we have to figure out which files we need for a query. Imagine that there could be 60,000 files over here. Which files do we need? We read the files. and select the points that are really needed. Via the index, fetch them, and somehow give them to the database. This is simply stated how this works, but please check the master thesis of Mosian. So this has shown the principle worked. It's also shown that it could work in heterogeneous environments, so you can have at the same time files of different format, text file, loss file, or set files. You can mix them. There is no initial load, so it's very fast in that respect. Several types of statements were implemented, the select, the insert, delete, and the update. This could be done efficiently by using the efficient loss tools implementation at file level, that these were kind of used in the wrapper. And in this way, it was possible to combine it with data in the database, for example, the polygon of a building and or administrative data. When we have a lot of these point cloud files, it is important to have metadata per file, the extent and the type. Is it a text file? Is it a loss binary file? Still, it's a kind of solution, because external files are dangerous. There's no control by the database. Somebody could, by accident, move them or delete them without the database being aware. Okay, to conclude, point clouds will become more important, especially in your career, and not only to do data acquisition, but also to represent spatial temporal objects. I think the way we explored with using this space filling curve keys is a very efficient way, also very generic, supporting the ND point clouds. So adding other dimensions such as time and level of detail. And these are very important for selection, for efficient selection. There were issues with the range generation, but with the histogram, okay, it has been reduced. Well, so it's a way, but it is reduced. Yeah, there is still a lot of work to be done. Also, not only at database level, also at web services level. Here are a number of links to projects that develop some new point cloud data management functionality. And the first one is point cloud, massive point cloud project, which was run by TU Delft. But there are also some other projects. And here you see some PhD thesis. This one was in Ireland, Aan-Vuurhoorn. This one was in France. And Haicheng Liu, who you may remember from the supervision and support in the labs, he is doing also his thesis on point clouds here in TU Delft. And this is the last slide. To make point clouds really mature, there should also be good standardization, same as we have it for vector data and raster data. And so maybe at the most generic level, there are two types of representations, the features and the coverages, let's say objects and the whole coverages of the domain, that will remain the same. But at the next level, the abstract data type level, I think beside the vector that is implementing features, the raster that is implementing coverages, I expect that point clouds should be added. And then at implementation level, you will see the different formats, both for the vector and the raster and the point terms. Okay, thanks for your attention. I will check one more time if there are any questions in the chat. Yeah, there is one question, and that was about the screen. Sorry, that was invisible for a while. But okay, please interrupt me during the lecture because only in the breaks I can see the chat. Thanks. Good luck this Wednesday with the lab assignment on point clouds. I will see you Friday at another distance lecture, and that is the last lecture of this series, and it will be on 3D models, vector models. Bye bye.